Good evening, Happy New Year, and welcome to the Institute of Politics first speaker series event in our winter quarter here on campus. It's great to have all of you with us tonight. My name is Steve Edwards. I'm the executive director of the IOP, and we are thrilled to have Raj Shah here for what we know will be an engrossing, timely, and important conversation around global health issues and global humanitarian crises more broadly. Before we formally introduce and launch our program, I just wanted to encourage all of you to be sure to sign up for our newsletter if you haven't already done so. I know many students and many regulars are well acquainted with our Monday newsletter, but for those of you who are not on that list, please go to our website at politics.uchicago.edu or check in down at the check-in table and make sure your name and email are on our list. That will keep you abreast of all the many things that go on here at the IOP throughout the academic year. We will be welcoming our full slate of winter quarter fellows this week and next week. Tomorrow afternoon at 4 o'clock at the Institute of Politics at 57th and Woodlawn, just around the corner, you can meet our new fellows. They include Palestinian journalists for NBC News. They include a New York Times journalist covering international sports, and two prominent political consultants who have worked on presidential campaigns, a Republican and Democrat each. We will have two more political consultants who will be joining us next week, and they will be leading a series that will take us through the entire primary process, give us a behind-the-scenes look at everything that's happening in this very fascinating and consequential presidential election. We will take a break in the middle of this conversation to involve you and your questions, as we always do here at the IOP. We'll have a stationary microphone set up for you to come forth and ask your questions to our guest tonight. When we do, we ask that you keep your questions short and to the point so we can get to as many of you as possible. We ask that you make your question a question. And it would also be great if you'd identify yourself as well. We want to give some priority to students, so we want to make sure they're in line as well. But community members are more than welcome to join the conversation and ask their questions too. Lastly, a quick note. Before coming over here, Raj sat down with our own David Axelrod for the latest installment of our new podcast. Some of you may be aware that last fall we launched a podcast. It's called The Axe Files, and it features one-on-one conversations that David leads with fascinating people and leaders in politics and policy today. You can subscribe via iTunes or get it from Stitcher or other apps. It's a great, great conversation, and one that you'll want to make a regular part of your listening habits. So without further ado, let me turn the microphone over to Henry Bensinger to formally get us started tonight. Henry is a familiar face and great leader here at the IOP. He's a third year in the college who hails from Chicago. He is, in addition to the many activities that he has been a leader in at the Institute of Politics, running most notably our Chicago-style series, is currently serving as interim president of the University of Chicago Democrats, and it's my great pleasure to turn the microphone over to him. Henry?
Thank you all for joining us this evening at the IOP's first event of the quarter, where we will be looking at global health crises. Today we have Dr. Raj Shah, who was the administrator of the U.S. Agency for International Development from 2010 to 2015, where he oversaw the U.S.'s response to the Ebola epidemic in West Africa. In addition, he led President Obama's Feed for the Future campaign, where he helped, which improved the nutrition of 12 million children in Africa. In April 2015, he was appointed by UN Secretary General to join a panel examining global health crises. In addition, moderating this conversation today, we have John Hewko, who is the CEO of Rotary International, which is one of the world's largest humanitarian organizations. Thank you all for joining us this evening, and please join me in a warm round of applause for our guests.
Well, thanks very much, Steve and Henry, for that warm introduction. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us, and special thanks to the Institute on Politics for hosting this event. So perhaps, Raj, we can just dive right into our topic, which is managing the global health crisis. And of course, you've played a very important role in some of the crucial global health issues that have come up through your time at the Gates Foundation and as USAID administrator. And as Henry mentioned, you're on the panel on pandemic threats, and they're about to, I guess, issue a report on the topic. And of course, we've just finished the Ebola crisis. So last week, I think the three West African Ebola nations were certified, I guess, as Ebola-free. And it was, of course, a terrible tragedy where we lost 11,000 lives, 28,000 illnesses, et cetera. So perhaps we could start with what have you learned from the Ebola experience? What went well? What didn't work out? Are we ready for the next pandemic or epidemic? In particular, perhaps you might tell us a bit about the global health security agenda and how does that all fit into this picture?
Sure. Well, thank you, John, and thank you also, Steve and Henry, for those kind introductory comments, especially Henry, for that nice introduction. It's really exciting to be here with all of you and to see such a strong turnout for the topic of global health crises. I'm happy to discuss that as well as other ones. You know, the Ebola crisis last year was in many ways indicative of some of the challenges we face around the world, but also the role America can and often does and needs to continue to play in leading the world to solve common global public problems. And I don't know how many of you here at some point during the time at which Ebola was in the news felt insecure about your own health and concern on behalf of your kids or your communities or families. But the truth is, compared to what was out in West Africa, Ebola barely touched the United States of America. And we were all quite safe relative to what was going on in West Africa. As John pointed out, 30,000 people got infected, 11,000 people died of a disease that really should be quite easy to contain. Contrary to popular belief, Ebola is not easily transmitted. And is not an aerosol-based transmission disease. And there were some, in my view, significant mistakes made in the early part of the Ebola response and some glaring inadequacies that we can get into in some of our big global public institutions like WHO that resulted in this disease getting completely out of control. And by the time last August, August before this past August, that we as a global community mounted what I would call an at-scale response, it was already too late to save the lives of those that were imperiled. I would say a couple of things that I think have been observed and learned about the Ebola crisis. The first is our preconceived notions of how to tackle these things are almost always inadequate to the task. And actually, I have this. Can I show one or two slides as part of this? Let me just flip ahead to this. This is a photo of a gentleman, obviously, who is suffering from Ebola, but this was taken in late July in Monrovia when people were quite literally dying in the streets and really not able to access care and support, but also not a part of a global or even local effort to prevent transmission. What our preconceived notion of beating Ebola was building Ebola treatment centers according to a very specific methodology and then treating people in those specific centers. It turns out what actually succeeded at rapidly and unequivocally reducing the transmission rate were something that had never been tried before, which were these burial teams that got, as you can see, suited up in protective equipment, went out to communities where people were dying of Ebola, and hopefully in a very dignified way, removed the dead bodies for a common burial practice prior to some of the local rituals taking hold, because those local rituals involved often women washing, kissing, hugging the bodies of the victims. And through that practice, they were exposing themselves, getting infected, and perpetrating the virus and the disease. So this was 70% of all transmission. It came down very, very fast. And it turns out a lot of the Ebola treatment centers we collectively built ended up being unnecessary. The second thing that we learned is diagnostics and data are everything. So the reality is, even the CDC and the WHO, until well into mid-November, were largely estimating the actual presence of Ebola based on reporting something called suspect, probable, and likely cases. And it wasn't until we deployed 11 of these biocontainment laboratory structures to the U.S. military throughout Liberia that we were able to get a very rapid and accurate diagnosis, pinpoint where was there actually an Ebola case, put it on a spreadsheet, send it around, and then let the first responders go out and deal with both that case and the contacts that were then traced. And the third thing that I think we learned is innovation is generally required to be effective. This is a photo of me struggling to put on and take off the protective equipment in Sierra Leone during my visit last October. And, you know, a lot of healthcare workers died in West Africa because as they would take the goggles off, their thumb would touch the mucous membranes around their eyes and nose, and they would contract the disease. We actually worked with a group of private companies and CDC and others to totally redesign the protective equipment suit to both be less scary for patients so that you could see their the faces of medical providers, but also to come off without requiring the 22-step process that was previously required, come off much more easily and safely to reduce the infection risk. And so what I learned is leadership, innovation, a focus on data and results are the core elements of driving a response. And if you then do those things, as you can see, once we've gotten going with that approach, the rate of reduction in transmission prevalence and the epidemiology went down very, very fast, much faster than anyone had expected. So I'd perhaps start there.
Yeah. Well, you were talking about the ultimate success in with the Ebola crisis. Polio is another example of where we've had significant success, and perhaps, you know, I could tell a bit about what my organization Rotary has done with polio. In 1985, Rotary, a nonprofit, not a government agency, not a multilateral institution, had really the audacity as an NGO to say, we are going to eradicate a disease from the face of the earth. We had 125 countries with polio, 350,000 cases a year, and 3 years later in 88, we were joined by the CDC, World Health Organization, UNICEF, and more recently by the Gates Foundation. And we're now down to just two countries, Afghanistan and Pakistan, where the wild virus has never been stopped, less than 70 cases so far this year. So again, another great example of success. So in terms of Ebola, polio, what again are some of the sort of critical lessons learned, and what can be used going forward as a legacy from both the Ebola and the polio eradication efforts?
Well, you know, first I'd say it's important. I don't know how many folks here are Rotarians. Is it you, John? Okay, good. Well, let me thank you, because what Rotary has done on polio is quite extraordinary, and you ran through the statistics very efficiently. But you know, people didn't think you could get this far in eradicating a major disease that was that pervasive. And you've shown the world that commitment, service, leadership, resources can in fact make a huge difference, and Rotary deserves to be proud of what is, I think, going to be one of the most profound accomplishments of these last several decades. So thank you. I think the lesson is very similar, is that when we come together as a global community and say we can achieve some aspiration towards justice, towards equity, towards fairness, and take on challenges like eradicating polio, ending Ebola in West Africa, transforming the scale and severity of the global crisis on HIV/AIDS, reducing malaria-related childhood deaths by 50% in sub-Saharan Africa from 1 million to 500,000, reducing the number of children under the age of 5 who die of simple diseases like diarrhea, pneumonia, birth asphyxia from 12.5 million to just 6 million now, and by 2030 it should be, in my view, less than 500,000. Humanity can achieve these extraordinary successes. And because they're not, you know, in the news every day, it's easy to lose sight of that and to be cynical about what we can accomplish when we come together and invest public resources, private ingenuity, student-led enthusiasm, and effective technology. But the story of global health is an unquestioned success story in serving the most vulnerable people on the planet. I spent a lot of time with the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation and helped create an effort called the Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization. The basic idea that it is part of a global concept of justice that every child born everywhere should receive a basic set of protective vaccinations was simply not being honored in 1990 or 2000. And since then, 500 million children have been vaccinated, 6 million lives have been saved, $12 or $13 billion have been raised, and new vaccines for rotavirus, pneumococcal conjugate, which causes pneumonia, and a host of other common pathogens have been not just invented, but also manufactured at a scale where they can reach all of the world's 105 million children who are born every year, not just the 30 or 40 million born in relatively rich countries. That mindset and that focus on achieving success, measuring results, is something we can continue to do in global health. And we have our work cut out for us because progress is going to be harder to come by. It's going to require more innovation. It's going to require more ingenuity, much better data visibility. But I think the Ebola crisis and the polio experience show that we can actually succeed.
So that's what we ask you. So if you were the world global health czar, what would be the one or two things that would keep you up at night in terms of the future pandemics? And what would you do to sort of address on a more global scale these issues of future pandemics, et cetera?
Well, the number one thing, I'll only give you one thing that keeps me up at night, is data. Because, you know, the Ebola, the story of what happened with Ebola, why it got out of hand, and why August and September and most of October were less effective at causing a reduction in transmission than just after that period, is entirely a story about data. And the truth is, you know, in a rich country, we insist on knowing if there's a disease outbreak somewhere, not just where is it and when did it occur, but who are the individuals, who have they touched and been in contact with, and how can we marshal resources there really quickly. You know, this year, 500,000 kids will die of malaria in sub-Saharan Africa. And we don't have a system to visualize where are those children, why is it that we can't protect them. And that might have been okay 25 years ago when the technology made it either prohibitively expensive or inconceivable. But today, and you know this story, but polio, what the Rotarians and the polio eradication effort did in northern Nigeria is show that you can succeed at data visualization. They used local on the ground SMS text information. They collected mobile phone data from very, very poor isolated communities, but still places where everybody has a mobile phone. And they used advanced satellite imagery and advanced image processing, put all that together and did a pretty effective village-based census of northern Nigeria that then served as the operational guidance for all the Rotarians and others to go out and make sure that every household was reached. And they succeeded. Who is reading stories about northern Nigeria, Boko Haram, the girls who were abducted, and thought, oh, this is the place we're going to eradicate polio? No one thought that. But you showed it could be done with sophistication, technology, and data. And I think one of the efforts that we've worked a lot on this panel that I've served on for Ban Ki-moon is to say the world should have that kind of a data visualization system that brings the rigor and focus of understanding where disease is and where and whom it kills on a global scale, particularly for poor countries.
Also, given the fact that really the world is flat now, all of us are plane ride away from Ebola or polio or whatever it is, how can we really better engage the American public to understand these issues and to support some of those efforts that you've just outlined going forward?
Well, America is a very generous country, as you all, I think, know. The United States spends about $8.5 billion a year in global health. That's almost a quarter of our total foreign aid and assistance budget. It is about 30 to 35% of total global donor expenditure on global health. And big efforts on a bipartisan basis. President Bush's effort to create PEPFAR, for HIV/AIDS and the President's Malaria Initiative, President Obama's efforts to increase funding for immunization and protecting women and children who would die during childbirth or in the first 5 years of life, have accounted for those big increases in public spending. And they've done it at a time when budgets have been overall constrained. So it shows you that our politics and our country can lead a global effort to end unjust death from simple diseases. And that's what I think we need to do going forward.
I mean, you talked about the increase in spending, et cetera, but also the misperception that, the Kaiser Foundation did a study that most Americans thought that 26% of our federal budget goes to foreign assistance, where, as you just said, it's really less than 1%. If you take out sort of defense-related, security-related issues, it's probably even less than that. So
when I ran USAID, we had a $22 billion a year budget. And people would say, oh, you're spending 20% of the federal budget on foreign aid. I'd say, I would be happy with 2%, because it would have been a more than doubling of our budget.
So give me then your elevator speech to common American who says, why should we be spending this money abroad when we have so many issues at home? What's the rationale, the story, and the reasoning behind why this is an important piece of our sort of foreign policy toolkit?
I got to tell you, I spent a lot of time across this country having that conversation, and I've kind of concluded that Americans don't even need an elevator speech to describe it. I mean, there is a strong moral streak within this country and our population, and a core belief that I certainly hold true, that America is an exceptional nation. My parents came here as immigrants, so I would have unique opportunities. I suspect that story is similar for so many of you in this room. And people get that. And I've been in, the Saddleback Church with 140,000 congregants who do a lot of global health work abroad. We're both from around Detroit. I've been in low-income settings in Baptist Church in inner-city Detroit, where people who are struggling to make ends meet are still putting $10 in a basket every week to send to an orphanage in Rwanda that church had adopted. It is a common American aspiration to serve others and to get a sense of meaning and purpose through that service. And I've always believed that if you just give people an opportunity to connect to this extraordinary mission, that for the first time in human history, we can end extreme poverty, that families and children do not have to grow up on living on a dollar and a quarter a day, that it is wrong that today, as we sit here in this stunningly beautiful building, a young girl born in South Sudan is still today more likely to die in childbirth than to complete high school. We can change that. We've changed it in so many places around the world, and we can see this through to completion by just 2030. That's what the world came together to agree to in September around these new sustainable development goals. And goals are important because they give you quantitative targets to aspire to achieve, things to measure and report on, and a way to hold people to account.
Right. Let's maybe shift a bit to talk about the foreign aid bureaucracy and USAID in particular. I remember before you took on the job of administrator, there were a lot of crises in the agency, bloated contracting agency, giving big checks to big beltway banded contractors and all of that. In fact, the agency that I had the privilege of helping set up, the Millennium Challenge Corporation, or MCC, in 2004, was created in some measure to respond to some of the concerns around AID. So, as your tenure as administrator, what were some of the reforms that you tried to implement? What do you feel were some of your successes, and what are some of the areas that you still feel the agency needs to improve on? And secondly, how do you view the entire foreign aid bureaucracy in general, all the various plethora of agencies are involved in some way or another in dealing with these issues, and what should the future look like in terms of our delivery bureaucracy and mechanisms?
So just to provide some context, USAID's about 10,000 people present in about 70 countries around the world. It is the world's largest humanitarian and development agency outside of the World Bank. It has a $22 billion a year annual budget. When I started, the agency had been through a really tough period. Over the prior decade, staffing had been cut 60%, and at the same time, there was a 300% increase in programmatic responsibilities often in war zones, Iraq and Afghanistan. And actually, you all are, I'm sure, quite aware of or have heard of some of the contracting problems that took place in the quote-unquote reconstruction of Iraq that I thought cast a pretty dark, you know, cloud around the agency. So when I started, actually my first week on the job was the Haiti earthquake, and my first phone call from the president was the night of the Haiti earthquake, when he said, you know, Raj, welcome to the job, but we're going to put you in charge of our global response to the earthquake, and he actually said, make us proud, and then moved on. I was like on the other end, ready to take all these notes, and he's like, make us proud. Then I was, line went silent. But the good news was he then went on television and said, you know, I just spoke to Administrator Shah and I've directed the following thing. So I could take notes describing what I was then supposed to do. But nevertheless, you know, that was an all-encompassing challenge where everybody had to work together to mount the largest humanitarian response in our history. And I learned from that you can do things very differently, even in a bureaucracy, especially with a sense of urgency and with the commitment of staff who are just so passionate about this mission. So, you know, we worked hard, we built progress and commitment from conservative, faith-driven Republicans and more liberal, globally-minded Democrats in the House and the Senate. We came up with a reform plan. We doubled the size of our foreign service. We dramatically improved our contracting processes and oversight and accountability. We put in place monitoring and evaluation so major programs get independent, third-party, data-driven evaluations. We cut and closed 380 programs around the world. We shut down 14 missions. We concentrated our resources on a smaller number of activities where we could measure results. Henry mentioned Feed the Future, which was a program modeled very much on the MCC, where we asked country governments to double their spending in agriculture and hunger, in the fight against hunger. And we brought science and technology and private sector partnership and investment. When I started, 9% of our $22 billion was spent in public-private partnerships. When I left, it was 45%, and today it's over 50%. So I think there has been a real transformation in how the work takes place. It's not just a transformation at one agency, at USAID, but it really is across the field. I give Bill and Melinda Gates and the Gates Foundation a lot of credit with bringing a technology and technical excellence expectation to this work. My counterparts, development ministers in European countries, were also focused on more accountability, more results, more measurement. Your former colleague and my good friend, Michael Gerson, who is a writer for the Washington Post, but one of the close advisors to President Bush who helped create the PEPFAR program, and I just wrote a paper for a book called Moneyball for Government, which you can get, I think, for free for a couple of days on Amazon. But Mike and I jointly co-authored this chapter and laid out five or six things we think the future administration should take into account. And the main theme is our work in this humanitarian enterprise is a part of how America expresses our values around the world. It's a part of how we build justice and democracy. It's a part of how we ensure that vulnerable populations can aspire to better livelihoods for themselves and protect themselves against the risks of going in other more dangerous directions. And therefore, doing this work with a level of excellence around results, around measurement, about evidence-driven expectations is important. And I think we've shown we can do that. And when we do, Congress, on both sides of the aisle, has shown they will support increases in our budgets and our capabilities. And I'll conclude this part with this one comment, which is during sequestration, which was a period of time where our politics in Washington were really, really rough, and budgets were cut on a across-the-board manner without very little kind of intelligence applied. There were only two agencies that got significant increases during those sequestration years, and it was USAID and NASA. And I'm proud of that, but I think that's partly because people saw we were trying to do the right thing and people were seeing the results we were able to deliver in programs like Feed the Future.
I mean, you just talked about some of the values that underpin our foreign international development efforts, but we're not the only game in town. Obviously, the Chinese in particular have been very aggressively moving into this space. They have a very different approach than the United States has to the criteria they use to give assistance, what they're trying to achieve through their assistance program. So how do you see that game playing out, the competition with the Chinese and perhaps others, and what do we need to do to ensure that that message that you just delivered is understood by the countries and that we're not, in effect, crowded out by the Chinese?
Well, and what John's referring to is that China has, over this period of time, really become a very significant source of financing and activity to support countries around the world in their aspirations for growth and infrastructure and resources to invest in their economies. It's a more controversial model for how they have conducted their work, often tying their loans and their grants to Chinese companies getting awarded contracts, sending very large numbers of mostly Chinese men to do the work who then stay for a long time, and in some cases abetting sort of public sector corruption in a way that really undermines the long-term viability of these economies. On the other hand, you know, at a time when countries are really starved for resources to build roads, build power plants, build modern infrastructure, and give their people a fighting shot at joining a global and growing economy, China has stepped into that task with a focus and a sense of purpose and a scale that most people haven't noticed. So to put that in perspective, the international loan book of the Chinese Development Bank is larger than the entire outstanding loan book of the World Bank. And very few people sort of have really thought through the consequences of that. More recently, in the last year, China helped create an Asian infrastructure bank. The United States found itself opposing that effort, but not really putting forth a viable alternative. And almost all of our European country partners and colleagues signed on to be a part of that effort, and I hope we will find a way to embrace it and bring the standards closer to what, you know, are the high standards we would aspire towards. So I don't know if that's a good answer. It's just context that, you know, the world will compete more aggressively for influence, engagement, trade relationships with fast-growing emerging economies. And doing this development work well is one way America can stay competitive. I'll give you two statistics to put that in perspective. One is, if you look at South Korea, after the Korean War, South Korea was a level of economic deprivation that was really quite low. Today, we have more jobs from our trade relationship with South Korea in the United States than we do jobs from our trade relationships with France. And USAID and our partnership with South Korea over 2-3 decades was a big part of the accelerant that helped that country achieve that high level of economic growth, and we're obviously extraordinarily close as a result of that. Today, 6 of the 10 fastest growing economies in the world are in sub-Saharan Africa. So yeah, China's engaging, Japan's engaging, lots of countries are engaging because people want to be the preferred partner over decades for economies that will in fact perform strongly over the long run.
You know, we're now in the middle of an election season. You talked about
always a time when there's good, lucid discussion of foreign policy.
Exactly. So, are there any, you know, candidates, either on the Republican or Democratic side, that you feel sort of got it in terms of international development, and that's one part. And the second is, you know, what
you know, Hillary Clinton swore me in. Right?
Right. Now that you're out of the administration, you're taking a more balanced approach on things. You know, are there any other than Hillary, I guess, other candidates that you feel on the right side of this issue from your perspective? And secondly, what advice would you give the new administrator coming in? I know there's a new one who's just sworn in, Gil Smith, but in the next administration, in terms of issues they should be looking at and the things that you felt you left on the table?
Well, let me tackle the presidential candidate's question first. I think, so of course I believe strongly that Hillary Clinton, then Secretary Clinton, and someone who has had a long history engaging on development efforts, felt passionately that we should have more resources, more effort, more people, more intention around this work, and would, I think, continue to elevate development as part of our foreign policy and foreign affairs if she were to be elected. On the Republican side, the only person who has really committed themselves publicly to that kind of vision is Marco Rubio, who has had a pretty active concept of American leadership using all of the tools, including, I don't like the term soft power for a variety of reasons, but including non-military forms of engagement around the world. Lindsey Graham is probably the most effective public advocate. I know he's not in the race anymore, but he used to say regularly that the 1% of the federal budget we spent on USAID was the best investment we could make at building a more peaceful and just world and protecting our own country in the long run. I'm not hearing that kind of clarity from our friends in the Trump campaign or other places in the election. And, you know, elections are not, I was actually kidding when I said elections are when you'd get lucid discussion of foreign policy. I don't expect much during this time period. I will say this, though. You know, and you guys got to be a part of this movement. We have to be more active as a country talking about and engaging on foreign affairs outside of the context of should we just go to war or not go to war. That's a responsibility that young people have to learn more and then express their thinking in a broader way so that our politics are not entirely defined and our foreign policy is certainly not defined by that binary set of decisions, because that's really just not the way the world is going to work over the next 30 years. If Afghanistan succeeds at preventing a Taliban takeover and having some stability without becoming a safe haven for terrorist activity, it will, in my mind, be because 8 million kids are in school and 3.5 million of those kids are girls, and none of those girls would have been in school, you know, under the Taliban. And that has changed families' expectations of what their children should get to aspire to, boy and girl. And we just have to think that way when we look at the world around us, because the threats that will challenge this country, Ebola from West Africa, terrorist threat from Iraq and Syria, you know, further collapse of other fragile states, are going to be very much defined by whether those populations in those countries want to aspire on behalf of their children for a better set of opportunities, or whether they are so disaffected that they just give up and say, you know, we have no other path but this wrong path. And America has always been a country that has projected our values around the world. Bono famously says, we're the only country in the world that's based on an idea, you know, and people get that. And he says, I'm Irishman and I'm the person talking this way. You know, I think our politics and I think our campaigns should talk more about what is the idea of this country? What are our values? Instead of having this crazy, nonsensical debate about excluding Muslims from the, I mean, that's crazy, but even the fight about should we let refugees in, you know, there are 4.2 million refugees coming out of Syria, 7.5 million displaced persons inside of Syria. Of the 4.2, 4 million are in and around Syria. They're in Turkey, Jordan, Lebanon. A couple hundred thousand have gone into Europe, probably less than 200,000. The United Nations has only asked the United States to take 25,000, of which we've only taken 2,600. And of those 2,600, in the 4 years that this program has been in place, not one has caused any red flag inside of the United States from a security perspective, zero. So to sit here and have a political argument, a presidential debate, like this is some part of a terrorist threat, just shows that most candidates don't know what a refugee is. And, you know, we've got to get smarter in how we talk about this, and a lot of that is you all holding candidates and others accountable to a higher level of dialogue.
Let me ask just one more question before we move on to the Q&A. Mark Zuckerberg just recently announced he's going to give away his entire fortune over the course of whatever, but he's structuring his philanthropy not through a traditional foundation, as some other super philanthropists have done, but through a limited liability company, the Chan Zuckerberg Initiative. Any thoughts on that? And is this a positive innovation? Is this a smokescreen that doesn't mean much? Reaction to his latest announcement?
Well, I think any commitment from anyone, frankly, super wealthy or not, that they're going to use their talents or their resources or their capabilities in this earth and this world to do good for others is something we should welcome, honor, and respect. And so I was very excited when I heard that announcement. I've been very excited about what Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and Melinda Gates have been able to do in building this giving pledge concept so that people who become billionaires now, at least in some settings, say, boy, there's an expectation that the bulk of these resources are going to go back to society. And how do I start to think about doing that in a good and productive manner? Whether a traditional foundation that spends 4, 5, 6% of its corpus on an annual payout or some other limited liability corporation is the right model, I think will play out over time. But you are seeing a lot of philanthropy today in China, in India, in Africa, and in Silicon Valley most famously, is being conducted through a range of tools that are broader than grant making out of traditional charities. I don't even like the term traditional charities because, you know, Rockefeller, I'm a trustee of the Rockefeller Foundation, would qualify as a traditional charity, but they practically invented the idea of scientific philanthropy. They developed the technology breakthroughs that powered the Green Revolution and moved 300 million people off the brink of starvation into the middle class in South Asia in the 70s and 80s. You know, they eradicated diseases, you know, and a lot of the progress that I've described in global health was grounded in a mindset they helped create through quote-unquote traditional charity done really, really, really well. So to me, the model that you use is less important than what you're getting done. And are you serious about measuring and learning and studying and bringing the kind of excellence, you know, you guys would certainly be expected to bring in your time here at this university to this larger global task?
Thank you, Raj. Maybe now we can turn to the audience and take some questions. There's a microphone here in the middle. Please don't be shy, and if you could just identify yourself and your affiliation when you ask your question. Sir.
Hi, my name is Yang. Thank you for your talk. I heard two things, two motivations for leading global health efforts by the United States. One is what you call the American exceptionalism, the ideal of influencing other people in other countries. Another is to have more engagement for, you know, further collaboration, either economically or diplomatically. So you also mentioned that there are lots of competition in this arena. It's more like individual heroism. So can you help us imagine a scenario that more concerted efforts by multinational efforts in the future? What would be the institution that would make this happen?
Well, thank you. I agree with you. I think there are many reasons why this work is important, right? We talked about our national security and projecting our values in a manner that creates more safety and connectivity in the way the world comes together, especially from fragile states. We talked about the economic benefits of being trading partners with countries that are small economies now, but rapidly growing, and what that can mean 10, 20, 30 years from now. And of course, I believe deeply that the moral mission is ultimately what, outside of the Beltway in Washington, what people tend to really care about. And I'll tell you, I had the opportunity to give an address at an event called the National Prayer Breakfast, which brings together Democrats and Republicans, the entire United States Congress, our ambassadorial corps, And I spoke about what it takes to end extreme poverty. And I was struck by just a huge outpouring of support that lasted for years after from all sides of the aisle towards that mission. So I frankly think we are just scratching the surface on building an American political basis for tackling big global problems like the ones we've been talking about, and we can do much, much, much more to make that very real.
Sir? Hi, my name's Kenneth Norman. I'm a local resident and alumni of the university. I used to live in Miami, and lots of Haitian friends. And I'd like to know if you could elaborate a little bit on the logistical problems of what happened after the earthquake in Haiti, which I followed very closely. I knew people on the island. And was there too much agency infighting between the U.S. versus the U.N. or private NGOs?
Well, thank you for the question. Sure, there's always some friction amongst institutions, but the real challenge was I visited the Port-au-Prince a few days after the earthquake with then Secretary Clinton, and President Preval met us on the tarmac, and we walked around Port-au-Prince with him, mostly around the airport area, but all the buildings had collapsed. The United Nations and 60, 70 of their great people on the ground perished in the collapse of their structure. Of the 22 Haitian ministries, 21 had collapsed. A government that was frankly not particularly functional the day before the earthquake simply ceased to exist, and President Preval was, you know, just trying to find family members of his lieutenants and see if they were alive. So, you can always do things better, more effectively, with more collaboration and less friction, but the core underlying challenge was that lack of capacity and capability in that moment. And I will say, even in that context, we actually got, hundreds of search and rescue people in quickly, saved hundreds of lives in that setting, got water distributed very fast. Today, 6 months after the earthquake, the diarrheal disease rate in Haiti was lower than it was the day before the earthquake in Port-au-Prince. A lot of things worked well in the context of the response. 3 million people were fed within 7 days of the response being stood up, and then we maintained that. We did digital payments into rural Haiti to support families taking people from Port-au-Prince. Today, the rate of child malnutrition in Haiti relative to the day before the earthquake has been cut in half. Food production is up more than 200%. Foreign direct investment on a monthly basis is up more than 100%. And the growth rate over the last 4 years has averaged around 4.5%. Still too low, but the decade prior to the earthquake, it was about 1%. So, a few things have been really effective. The biggest challenge was housing and reconstruction. The biggest challenge there was rubble removal. And the reason that was such a problem was we had identified staging sites to move the rubble to, but frankly, the Haitian government was unable to exercise eminent domain because so much of the political power of that country resides in Miami, apparently with families that are less interested in seeing the countries be successful relative to their private interests. And, that, by the way, that specific topic of eminent domain over four specific staging sites on a map was a conversation we had with President Preval when he visited President Obama in the Oval Office. And we said, we cannot help you if you cannot do this. But it's been a long road, but one that I'm proud has delivered some really significant successes.
Thank you for that. I appreciate it.
My name is Monica Matsumoto. I'm a first-year medical student here at University of Chicago. And I'm just wondering, with your experience with USAID and some of the projects you've implemented, if you've ever experienced pushback from local population or local governments, and if so, what did you do to engage with them and, I guess, influence them in a positive way?
Well, I was once a first-year medical student, so it's great to hear that. I'm glad I'm not anymore, by the way. I know how hard you gotta work. All over the world, the challenge of engaging local communities is very, very important in conducting programs. Often, programs are ineffective because they haven't built that kind of community engagement. So I showed you the photo of the burial teams in Liberia. We tried the same burial team strategy in Sierra Leone 6 weeks later because we had really good data on how effective it was in Liberia. And it just wasn't working. And we were like, why is this not reducing transmission when it was working so effectively in Monrovia? The answer was, those folks in those masks worked for a group called Global Communities. They had been in these communities for a long time. They were trusted, they were understood, and people thought of them as on their side. In Sierra Leone, they were kind of British Save the Children people who had just flown in, put the masks on, walked in, and they scared the daylights out of folks in these communities who didn't engage with them effectively. So effective community engagement is an absolutely important strategy to be successful anywhere in the world. Now, in my job, I often had to negotiate with leaders about how we were going to use the resources. And we very much wanted our efforts to be country-led. The country leaders say, okay, I want to end child death in my country. I will, accept this $300-400 million. Let's do this together. Let's measure results, this and that. But there were times when I'd run into a foreign minister or a president who would say, educating girls or saving children's lives for immunizations, those are local things, so we don't really pay that much attention to them. We'd like the money for, the officers' club or, certain infrastructure things. And I don't mean to imply it's all corrupt. I mean, it's just a different set of priorities. Sometimes it is corrupt. And I would have to make the case, and that would sometimes be an intense conversation, but that's part of negotiating what you're going to do together, and remembering that our mission is yes to support the country and the country's leadership, but it is really to end extreme poverty and to focus on the country's people, and from Pakistan to Mali. The leaders I dealt with were not always fully interested in representing the needs of vulnerable populations in their countries, and those were more difficult discussions.
Hi, thank you. It's been a very enlightening talk. I'm Victoria Okunaya. I'm a second-year MD-PhD student here. And
wow.
I was wondering if you could touch on sort of this idea. I know that you say you have a mission on global health and working as a community and as a country, and you briefly talked about how we have some private interests. But I wonder how, if you could touch on how we tackle, in our future vision of a country, our conflicting interests. So I know in the health sector, we're talking a lot about the emerging threat of antibiotic resistance, but a major issue in that is capitalism and the people who aren't listening there in terms of the food sector and agriculture industry listening to that emerging threat. And we already know that pharmaceutical is also the biggest lobbyist in the country, and that is a major force in terms of our global aid and our capacity to provide global aid. So to say that we as a country are not partially implicated in the sort of landscape of the global health scene, I think is kind of naive, and I just wonder how we should look towards as young people in terms of tackling the issue of how our own capitalism affects and contributes to global poverty and us not as a multinational sector meeting our sustainability development goals and such.
Well, thank you. That's a good question, a little tougher, but good. And I think at the end of the day, if you're trying to achieve certain goals in global health, you are going to need to find and connect with all kinds of partners to achieve those goals. And, sometimes that will mean partnering with pharmaceutical companies in order to gain access to product or pricing benefits or R&D that can help solve a problem that otherwise wouldn't be solved. Sometimes that will mean focusing on faith-based partnerships that in many parts of the world provide a large percentage of the healthcare in urban slums in particular in, say, East Africa, right? So the idea that fundamentally to be successful you gotta partner with a broad range of partners, if you accept that, then you really have to respect where those partners are coming from. So, for example, we did major partnerships with pharmaceutical companies around immunization and getting access to certain kinds of vaccines and getting them deployed in poor parts of the world. We took years to learn about what are the economics for that vaccine company. And I don't, frankly, I don't have the luxury of debating whether the world they live in and the capitalism that defines the world they live in is right or wrong. It just is. If I want GSK to manufacture tens of millions of doses of a particular vaccine product, in this case Prevnar, and I want to get it at 1/8 or 1/10 the cost of what they're selling it at to the hospital in Chicago, I got to start learning their world, talking to them, engaging with them, and coming up with solutions that work for them. And so I agree with you that the fact that I use that example because Prevnar, I think, is a $55, $60 product, at least it was a few years ago here in the United States. At that price point, it would never get to poor children, ever. And I think we were able to negotiate something considerably lower by doing a large-scale volume contract and engaging them and providing enough security on the, to them on the revenue side that that worked. And one could appropriately critique the capitalist tendencies to price the way they price here and around the world. But, you know, my primary goal in that context was using my authorities to help vaccinate poor children. And the best way to do that was to do a deal with them and understand where they're coming from. So,
do you find a role for the general public?
The general public in what?
In levering.
Debating.
Force, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I do. I do. You know, Bill Gates gave a great speech like 10 years ago called Creative Capitalism and made the case that without asking companies and leaders to sacrifice a lot of their economic incentive, you can still get them to do things that are more broadly gauged and socially minded. And I don't know that that concept is transforming American capitalism, but I do know CEO after CEO who I was able to work with very effectively, and they did things that on day one didn't look like they were maximizing their profitability by doing it, but you know, they were committed to the mission, they were committed to the long-term economic opportunity represented by agriculture in Africa or vaccine sales in India or some other, you know, diagnostic productions for West Africa. And they did things, but I think a lot of why they did those things is they also were motivated as leaders to use their power and their technology and their logistics for some real good purpose in the world. And we wanted to honor that and recognize it and celebrate it and encourage more of it.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mary May, and I'm a student at the business school here. I was actually in Liberia with the WHO rep, okay, when the first cases of Ebola arrived in Monrovia, so I followed the...
In June.
Yeah. So I followed the epidemic very closely, and you've talked a lot tonight about the importance of data in kind of bringing down cases. But I know that behavior change communication is also a big part of that. So I was wondering if you could talk about the innovations that have made it, that have been made in that area.
Yeah, that's great. So that's an excellent point. And the reality is, you know, by the time we got into the fall, in Monrovia is a great example. I mean, nobody went into a building without washing their hands with chlorinated water and washing their feet if they'd walked into a hot zone setting, and not, people weren't shaking hands anymore, they were doing the elbow bumps, and those types of things. And that cultural change in practice, born out of fear and dire circumstance, made a huge difference in helping to reduce the rate of transmission. So you're absolutely right about that. And it also, by the way, shows, because a lot of people who have previously worked on behavior change say, well, it takes a really long time. It also shows it doesn't have to take a really long time if people are scared enough in that setting. And if the leadership is bold enough, as Ellen Johnson Sirleaf was, it can move much faster. And I think there's some lessons there that we can use for everything from malaria prevention to the transmission of other diseases that seem less urgent or epidemic-like, pandemic-like, but it will be just as critical.
Hi, thank you for joining us. I'm Gabby Weimer. I'm a fourth year in the college, and I'm currently working on a thesis that's comparing the Rockefeller Foundation and the Gates Foundation and the role that they've played in global health. And I've come across
Email me this when you're done. When are you going to be done with this?
So hopefully April is when it's due, so that's when it should be done.
All right, send it to me as soon as it's done.
But in the process of doing research, I've come across a lot of criticisms of the foundations and the influence that they've had on the field of global health, specifically because of the amount of money that they have and how that kind of shapes the discussion. I'm thinking specifically of malaria eradication and how the Gates Foundation has decided that that's the way they want to approach it, and being the second largest donor to the World Health Organization, that's kind of the method that the rest of the world has decided is the way forward, despite some criticisms of that and some arguments that more broad-based healthcare infrastructure development is the best way to tackle some of these issues. So I'm curious how you respond to these sorts of criticisms and whether you think the Gates Foundation should make changes and whether there should be some more mechanisms in place to provide oversight of private foundations and how they allocate their resources.
Excellent, excellent question. So you're going to have a better answer when you're done your thesis than I'll have right now. I would note, I think it's true that these large private institutions do exert quite a lot of influence over the field. I know Bill and Melinda in particular are very sensitive to that and try, you know, their best to listen and learn and understand critique and be really engaged and are not making decisions kind of glibly or irresponsibly, but there's no question in my mind that they and other folks in that world do hold a lot of concentrated power because they, you know, define expenditures and strategies. I guess if there's an area I might push back, it would just be to say, I have found the challenge hasn't been too much leadership, it's not enough. And if those people and institutions were to not be present, I don't think like a WHO committee of 42 people is going to step into the leadership void and rally the world to accomplish something special. You know, leadership matters. It matters in every walk of life. It matters in foreign policy a lot, and it matters in global health. There's a great book about Jim Grant, a famous director of UNICEF, helped lead a major push for immunization and child survival in the 70s. But like the force of will of Jim Grant going to country leaders and just insisting on performance and pushing everyone made a huge difference. A Rockefeller grantee who went on to win the Nobel Peace Prize, the Presidential Medal of Freedom, and the Congressional Medal of Honor, Norman Borlaug, was an agricultural scientist who invented dwarf wheat varieties that improved wheat production and led to the Green Revolution. But the scientific breakthrough is only part of it. Dr. Borlaug put seed in his pocket and smuggled it into Pakistan when he wasn't allowed to, planted it in a field when no one would come talk to him, somehow managed to get a finance minister and to go to that field and see the performance of his wheat versus the wheat they were growing, and just stayed on top of it day in and day out until country after country after country adopted an approach to improving agriculture through science and productivity that we now call the Green Revolution, and it saved hundreds of millions of lives. So he held a lot of concentrated power. But, you know, I would just make the case I know there are a lot of young people here that are really smart and have huge potential in the future. We need you to become leaders in this field. We need you to become information masters and mavens on the topics you want to tackle. And I think we need more leadership, not more, you know, not less so, if we're going to end polio, have no children at the age of 5 die of simple diseases, and work towards a world that's effectively ending extreme poverty.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think we've run out of time. I apologize to the remaining questions. We have some more time, Steve, or should we?
Let's take
one last question and then ask Raj perhaps for some closing thoughts as we wrap up the evening, please.
I'll try to make this count then. Well, thank you both for a great discussion. I'm Richard and I'm first year at the college. So you mentioned that almost in every scenario there's been some kind of private sector involvement, whether it's through investment or private-public partnerships. But it seems that the only examples have been, you know, big CEOs at pharmaceutical companies. Can you give us a few small success stories of, I guess, smaller bodies of the private sector who have played a critical role in delivering these solutions?
Sure. Well, actually, you're exactly right that if you look at, you know, just one example, is we created something called the Global Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition in Africa, and dramatically increased the amount of private investment in improving agriculture and nutrition in a host of countries that had signed on to making certain policy reforms. And here's basically how it worked. We worked hard to negotiate with country leaders, the heads of state and the parliaments, a set of policy reforms, respect for private capital, clarity around regulatory behavior, fighting corruption in certain parts of their government. And then we got local companies together to make commitments to invest and expand their capabilities based on the country implementing those reforms. And, you know, whether it's a small nut processing company in Ghana or a cut flour business in Tanzania or a rice plantation in Mozambique, those are the businesses that powered billions of dollars of additional investment in total across hundreds of small companies and small entrepreneurial businesses. And you're absolutely right, that's the force for change that makes all the rest of this possible. And that's one example in agriculture, there are examples in health and in every walk of life and development where that unleashing that entrepreneurial activity is what helps countries grow and helps these problems get solved at scale.
Well, please join me in thanking not only Raj for a tremendous window into this world and to the many complicated challenges and opportunities to affect positive change, but also for John leading a wonderful conversation. Please join me in thanking Raj and John for tonight's event. Please also join me in a round of applause for our event staff and our event ambassadors, the many students who check in, all of our guests, and orchestrate tonight. I don't thank them enough, and thanks as well to Henry for his leadership tonight. So join me in thanking them, and we hope to see you back here for another event very soon. Politics.uchicago.edu, those of you who are interested in these issues, we have a number of events coming up this quarter. Ben Rollins will be in. He was just on Fresh Air talking about his new book. He'll be coming this quarter. I mentioned one of our fellows, Roger Abu Zarefa, who will be leading a series on Wednesdays, some of which will take us inside just day-to-day life in Gaza. So that'll be among the many upcoming sessions. So thank you all so much. We hope to see you again in the future. And thanks again to Raj and John.